There was a debate, a famous debate on Democracy Now with Ewan Dershowitz, where you were discussing his book, The Case for Israel.
His book in quotation marks.
Well, I was going to say that Norman said on Democracy Now, separate, which kind of gone down. He said on Democracy Now, which kind of gone down well with Alan Dershowitz, that not only did Norman think that he hadn't written The Case for Israel, but he also thought that he actually hadn't read The Case for Israel, that he hadn't read his own book. And he produced, as Norman usually does, pretty forensic and irrefutable evidence to back up the claim that he was making. And it was kind of humiliating for Dershowitz, I think. I mean, it was right to call him on this, but that can't have been an easy encounter for him. So that was a couple of years prior to what happened at DePaul, and he really did lead the charge. I mean, he submitted letters to the administration of DePaul saying that it would be an outrage if they granted you tenure. And he's a powerful guy. I mean, he's got a serious platform amongst very influential people. Do you want to talk about that a bit? I mean, you subsequently met him, didn't you, in a restaurant? That was quite an extraordinary interview, a video of Norman Dershowitz running into each other. But yeah, why don't you talk about that for a bit more?
Professor Dershowitz, I never had much interest in him intellectually. I don't think there's very much there. There probably once was, but his output in the last 30 years has been really quite unimpressive, as I told him, and I'll get to that in a moment. but I did... I was on the program with him, and I thought the book was just a tissue of lies. It was just a complete fabrication. I didn't think that he, in the course of exchanges with him, it went on for quite a long time. It was an hour on air, and then Amy Goodman, it was Democracy Now!, insisted that we sit for another hour after the program. So it went on for quite a long time. I got very impatient. I'll admit I got very impatient because it was totally unserious. The fellow was a serial liar. And at one point I just pulled the earphones on. At that point they still used earphones. And I was starting to walk off, and then Amy said, "Get back there." I didn't want to quarrel with her because she was at the time a friend. So I went back. I kept saying to him, "The book you claim to have written, the book you," and I was purposely trying to get a rise out of him, I'm not going to deny that, "the book you claim to have written." And finally, after I said that about two or three times, he said, "What do you mean claim?" I said, "Well, for your sake, Professor Dershowitz, I hope you didn't write that book." And then afterwards, he went around complaining to everyone that it was an ambush. It was an ambush. I ambushed him. And Amy Goodman and I had ambushed him. And I said, "Well, you know, he does have an argument, because it really was unfair that between the two of us, only one of us had read his book." Yes, he did a lot more than what you described, Colin. I want to be factual about it. I'm not out to get revenge. This is not a kind of exercise in vindictiveness, but the facts speak for themselves. He contacted the chair of my department the chair of the department contacted him first, about a year before the tenure battle began. They began to collude together. The chair of the department wrote up the annual evaluation of me. And even though I was in all student evaluations, the top-rated professor in the department, he ranked me the worst professor in the department. He called my scholarship worthless. And I could see they're creating a foundation to get rid of me. It came out later that Dershowitz had been in collusion with him. And then the last few months, Dershowitz circulated, no joke, it's just hard to believe, a 60-page dossier on me, which he sent to every single faculty and administrator at the pool. 60 pages. It was a real tour de force. And then that then caused the department to panic, my political science department, like what were they getting into now? And they started organizing all these committees to evaluate all the allegations against me. And I had to spend days upon days upon days, then weeks, then months, answering all the charges that were being leveled against me about my scholarship. So he played a very vicious role, and then the level of the viciousness escalated. He was trying to get a rise out of me, and he started going around saying that my late mother was a capo, a collaborator with the Nazis. It started to really go right from the street into the sewer. And that caused new moral dilemmas for me, which I'll get to in a half moment. But the fact of the matter is, I don't think his was the decisive factor in denying me tenure. And it was more, I think, the problem you mentioned. It was not an intellectual issue. It was a political issue. There were substantial forces which wanted to stop me. And the way you stop me is by denying me tenure, and then you go around saying, why are you listening to Finkelstein? He's such a non-entity, he couldn't even get tenure at the pool. And it was actually a quite successful strategy, because that's exactly what did happen afterwards. You couldn't even get tenure at the pool, so why listen to this guy? After the whole thing, I can't give the names because I'm sort of sworn to secrecy, but I'll just give the general picture. A major person in the faculty met with the provost. The provost's name I'll give because I have no respect for him. Helmut Epp met with Epp, and Epp said to him, one of the things with the pool was when we're going through the settlement issue, they didn't quarrel with the amount of money we were asking. They quarreled over what the final settlement statement would read. But on the issue of money, and my lawyer was asking for a quite substantial amount, relatively speaking, it was a substantial amount. And they immediately gave in on that. And I was kind of surprised, as was my lawyer. And then when the faculty member met with Epp a couple of years after the whole debacle, he said to me, look, he said to the faculty representative, he said, look, we all knew that Finkelstein was the smartest guy in the faculty. Before you were impressed, you know, that's like saying the tallest building in Wichita, Kansas, the smartest guy in the pool's faculty. But he said, we couldn't keep him. There was no way we could keep him. And he said, that's why we didn't quarrel about the money, because we felt we wasted 6 years of his life. We couldn't keep him. So I think Dershowitz was a factor, yes, and what he did was vicious, yes, but I think it was a much bigger problem. It was a political problem for a Catholic university, which is exposed on the issue of anti-Semitism, having me on its faculty.